be seated.
Unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains just a single grain. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. Today is Sunday, the 17th of March, your friendly reminder, which means it's the fifth Sunday in Lent. But for those who know, it's also the feast of St. Patrick, who apocryphally drove the snakes out of Ireland, who brought the faith to a pagan land, and who's nominally a saint. No one ever actually made him a saint. We just call him a saint. But it's also the feast of the lesser known St. Gertrude of Nivelle. Anyone know St. Gertrude? She should be more famous. She's the patron saint of cats and cat lovers. She was also a very scholarly woman who devoted her life as a monastic to the sick, the elderly, and the poor. So whether you have Irish heritage like me and you celebrate St. Patrick, or you like cats and you celebrate St. Gertrude, but they're mutually exclusive. I don't think you can do both. Today is a great day, as long as you don't have a snake and a cat in the room at the same time. But today's also called Passion Sunday, or it used to be called Passion Sunday, beginning the 2 weeks leading into the Easter Vigil. We don't really follow that old calendar anymore since Vatican II, but it is the day we veil our crosses and images, and we turn our focus to the passion and crucifixion of the Lord. So it's a significant turning point in Lent, and it's also a turning point in John's Gospel. So in today's reading in John's Gospel comes after Jesus has raised Lazarus from the dead and the leaders, the high priest, committed to killing him, killing one person for the sake of the nation. It comes after he was anointed with oil all over his head by Mary at Bethany, preparing him for death. And it comes after his triumphant entry into Jerusalem, which is a bit confusing because we celebrate that next week with Palm Sunday. So that just reminds us that when it comes to the Gospels and the church calendar, time is an abstract concept. So Jesus says, with the arrival of some Greeks, some Gentiles from further away, they were either Gentiles or diaspora Jews who've heard about this rabbi and they want to see him. And just by them asking to see him, Jesus says, the hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. That makes sense if you'd read the verse, the one line immediately preceding today's gospel, where the leaders were frustrated and yelling out, the whole world is chasing after him. And then those from the further reaches of the world come to see him. It's really important to know that in John's Gospel, Jesus' glorification is found in the cross and the resurrection. It's both and. And there's significant differences between his and the synoptic Gospels. For instance, in Mark's Gospel, Jesus cries out from the cross, my God, why have you forsaken me? But in John's Gospel, he quietly says, it is finished. It is accomplished. In the Garden of Gethsemane in Mark, Jesus prays, Abba, Father, for you all things are possible. Remove this cup from me, yet not my will but yours. And yet in today's gospel, very similar words but different emphases. This is sort of John's Garden of Gethsemane moment. Jesus says, almost embracing the cross, he says, now my soul is troubled. And what should I say? Should I say, Father, save me from this hour? No. No, it is for this reason that I have come to this hour, glorify your name. He knows that this hour means he will go to the cross, and he embraces it. The suffering on the cross is how Jesus will become the source of eternal salvation for all. Our epistle to the Hebrews tells us today, the last verse there. That's because Jesus knows not just the suffering of the cross, but the joy of the resurrection that is to come. So, up until now in John's Gospel, Jesus has been saying, my hour has not yet arrived, from as early as chapter 2. But now it comes as no surprise when he says his hour has come. And he gives that very agricultural description. His death will be like a seed that falls to the ground, and even though it dies, it bears much fruit. Some of us have been thinking about seeds the past couple of weeks because St. Luke's Community Garden is almost ready to have its first planting. So we've been wondering what we'll plant and when. And the autumn planting will probably include wonderful things like broad beans and carrots and cabbage and peas and artichokes and radishes and Chico's favourite silver beet. No. But there's wonderful anticipation of this garden flourishing, being renewed by the autumn rain, growing abundantly, and then feeding us who work in that garden and those in the community who might come in need. And let's face it, we all know how expensive our vegetables are at the grocery store at the moment. Wonderful, freshly grown food is really life-giving. But to be honest, I can't wait until summer. Summer when we grow corn. And as Chico would say, corn, I can tell you all about it. She gets it. Back in Kenya, everyone grows corn. Everyone grows corn in their back garden, even if you've only got a small plot. It's corn or maize. And that's for numerous reasons. It's staple. It's a staple. It's hardy. It's productive. And it's plentiful. Now, I know Jesus wasn't talking about corn, he was talking about wheat, but can you work with me here for a moment? Because they both grow from seeds. Unless a seed falls into the earth and dies. Seeds that have an outer shell, and as I discovered this week, because I'm a bit slow on the uptake, they also have an inner embryo. And so, after years, decades even, a seed could be planted and still grow because the embryos don't really die inside that seed as much as lay dormant. That might be a helpful way of us thinking about Jesus' passion, death, and resurrection. So if Jesus describes himself as the seed, then perhaps the embryo held safe inside the seed could be the church, us. I'll say that again, because I know we're all watching to see what Rowan gets up to in the sacristy. If he comes out in a chasuble, I'll hand over to him. If Jesus describes himself as the seed, then perhaps the embryo, that which is held safe inside the seed, could be the church. Be us. It's you. Unless a seed falls into the earth and dies, it remains just a single seed. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. So I need you to use your imaginations to picture a field of corn, whether it's from the movie Field of Dreams, which is a baseball field surrounded by corn, whether it's from your time in the country, your backyard. Whatever it might be, picture a field of corn that's grown up over 6 feet high and you're working your way through it. From that one seed planted in the ground, its roots dig into the rich soil and grows downwards. The stalk grows upwards over 6 feet tall And going out from it are the ears of corn, bursting with each one bursting with hundreds of kernels inside, full of sweet and beautiful corn. All from a single seed. Now think about it, that seed contains all the genetic information needed to grow what it will become. Whether that's an ear of corn or a grapevine, another image Jesus uses, or an acorn growing into a giant oak, it already has all it needs to know to become what it is to become. Maybe that's the same with Jesus and the church. We share not just who he was, but what he is in our DNA. He's already told us what we should grow into. But more than that, he's living into that through us. We are not alone, that means. This is a covenant with him. It's part of the covenant Jeremiah was talking about in the first reading. It's good to me remember the covenant is not just a legal arrangement. Covenant is a relationship. That's why we call marriage a covenant. It's a relationship, and God has written the law of love on our hearts through Jesus by the Holy Spirit. God's love has been made perfect in Jesus, in his sacrifice on the cross, and that love grows in us and through us. And this is a sacrifice on the cross that Jesus says will draw all people to himself. Or as one translator says, drag all people to himself like he's cast a net wide. All people. No one is outside this love. We're all in the field that Jesus has planted. We're here nourished by the scriptures, we're fed by the sacrament, we're fertilized by God's mercy and compassion and forgiveness, we're watered by prayer and fellowship. Friends, you are the fruit that Jesus died for, so that you may grow and flourish. Like St. Patrick, are called to flourish in sharing the good news, like Gertrude, caring for the poor, the sick, the widow, the orphan. We, like the saints, can live lives that bear the image of Christ. Look around this church at your fellow Christians. Look and see what Christ's life, death, and resurrection have become. It's become you. And now as we enter into Passion Tide and we face the cross, you might ask yourself one question. Are you willing to live like you've been died for? The Lord be with you.